You know what? It don't even matter. We're uploading two videos this week. You're welcome. Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davy Chappie, and if you've seen my cleric or my wizard videos, then you know that I am personally of the opinion that the company, known as Wizards of the Coast, may have been playing favorites with certain classes during the design of 5e, because between these two classes alone, you have about 1/4 of the entire classes in the game. Despite this, the voracious appetite of the Wizards conglomerate cannot be sated, so here we are, going over not two, but three new archetypes to take the multiverse by storm, in the forms of the Twilight Domain Cleric, the Circle of Wildfire Druid, and the Onomancy Wizard. So, with out of the way, let's begin. Our first new domain for the bros and robes is the Domain of Twilight, which is an interesting specialization in that there isn't really a concrete description for what it is. It represents healing and rest, but also bravery and protection, traveling, dreams, nighttime, the transition to nighttime. It sort of keeps itself polyamorous in the world of domains. In terms of abilities, you get proficiency with martial weapons and heavy armor, you have infinite dark vision, and you can spend an action to give your friends infinite dark vision, and you can give any one person, including yourself, advantage on initiative rolls. Moving on from level 1, your Twilight Cleric will quickly learn to make a bubble that gives temporary hit points and shakes off fear or charm effects. You yourself will get advantage against fear effects. You can give yourself a flying speed for one turn as a bonus action while you're in darkness. You get a psychic divine strike, which, if you don't know what a divine strike is, howdy, welcome to clerics. And your final ability lets you choose an amount of people when you cast the darkness spell who get to see through the darkness as if they had
magical dark vision.
This class is bonkers, and as a DM, I immediately hate it so much, like on a personal level. The
infinite dark vision
is ridiculous because nobody else has that, so fighting in darkness isn't a challenge anymore. You just stay out of their line of sight, and there may as well not even be enemies. The bubble of temporary HP is ridiculous for somehow being even more of a sponge than the heroism paladin from the last UA? Because the bubble doesn't just heal you once, it heals you every time you end your turn in it, and I understand that that's only temporary HP, but considering you get this at level 2, at low levels, that extra d8 may as well be a normal healing for anybody that gets hit each turn. You know, like the frontliners, like the cleric.
Especially the cleric.
The flying speed is fine, the divine strike is a divine strike, and by level 17, the darkness ability just means that any non-boss enemy that the party fights has a 0% chance of winning, and if you don't believe me, look at the Shadow Sorcerer, and then multiply that rudeness by 4 to 5 party members. Blizzards, please nerf. Taking a break from ranting and moving on to the subclass that I was personally excited for, the Circle of Wildfire Druid took a look at all the press coverage that California gets and decided that this was the quickest way to get on television. Wildfire Druids believe that Smokey the Bear is fascist propaganda that gets in the way of teaching people that part of nature's beautiful and blossoming growth cycle is the part where everything dies and burns so that new stuff can grow there. The Circle of Wildfire starts out with the Firebolt cantrip, and while I don't normally talk about bonus spells, it's worth mentioning that this archetype gives Druids Fireball, which I'm sure that they will only use responsibly. Never mind that they also get locate plants and animals so that they can hunt down and destroy every woodland critter that dares to run away from a fiery, crispy death by druid. But after that, the Wildfire Druid can summon a spirit of destruction that no doubt is an evil demon that has possessed the druid's mind and body. And this sentient little creature acts as a pet that'll act on your initiative count and burn every goddamn thing in its path. And it can even teleport the people around it once per short rest, which I'm sure must make some sort of sense somewhere. Anyway, the spirit sticks around for 1 hour or until it gets beat up for being a nuisance, which is good to know considering the next ability synergizes with it by letting you add a d8 to any fire-based spell or healing spell whenever the wildfire spirit is around. And you can use the spirit as a transmitter through which to cast those spells. Your next ability lets you cause flames to burst from creatures that die around you so that not even the remains are spared from your torment. And the flames will either heal or hurt anybody that touches them, and your last ability lets you resist death once and gain temporary HP equal to 5 times your druid level and set anybody around you on fire. I'm not sure if anybody has told the testing team this, but the druid has a reputation for being completely impossible to kill, and that last feature just cements it. Granted, you don't get it until level 14, but once that hits, the DM can just pretend that the druid is an unkillable wall in the shape of a druid, and the wall is on fire. To be fair, I don't have too many problems with this subclass, it just sort of does more of what the druid is already supposed to do. Maybe it does it a little too much, but it's up to opinion. I just really didn't expect the pyromancer archetype that we've been waiting for to come from one of the least straightforward classes in the game.
Especially the druid.
And finally, the subclass that, judging from the Twitter comment section, clearly nobody likes, and how dare they even include it in playtest material, the Onomancy School of Magic asks, "What's your name, man?" and then beats the hell out of you for answering. First off, the Onomancy School, not to be confused with the Oncology School, gives you proficiency in calligrapher's tools and lets you use a bonus action to charm someone and learn their true name or their lack of one. The Bane and Bless spells are also added into your spellbook, and you can cast them without spending a spell slot as long as you speak the true name of the person that you're casting it on. After that, you get the power of Resonant Utterance, which does just far too much for me to explain. Just look at this. The important bits is that you can choose two of them and two more at level 10, and then from then on, when you speak your target's true name, you can add the Resonance effect onto it that can do things like give you temporary hit points, give disadvantage on saving throws, deal extra damage, nullify spells already on them, move them, or target them as long as they're in range, regardless of other circumstances. Finally, your last ability says that when you speak your target's true name, you can change the damage type of your spell to either psychic or force damage as a means of bypassing any resistances that they might have. Overall, I think that the beginning abilities are a bit much, but after that it's not that offensive. Getting a level 2 charm that you can just do up to 5 times is a little silly, and it's not like it's even a necessary feature for you to get someone's name, since your average person is usually fine with answering a benign question like, "What is your name?" without assuming that they're just giving you ultimate boning permission. The Bane and Bless are also pretty silly, because it means that even when you don't have enemies to fight, you're gonna know your friends' names, so you're just getting a bunch of free blesses whenever you want. The Resonance don't bother me much,
except for the ones that give you free dispel magics on, no.
Because I see them as pretty similar to a fighter's maneuverability dice, and they're pretty restricted by whose name you do and don't know, although I do think that scaling them up is a little extra. Finally, the damage type change ability, it exists. I mean, it's not bad by any means. You basically get to guarantee that they don't get to resist your spell, but I wouldn't call it overpowered. It's still doing the same amount of damage, and it's not a guarantee that the spell that you're casting would even be resisted by the person you're casting it on. Really, if anybody remembers the olden days when true name magic was, not good, it's interesting to see that the true name archetype is maybe getting a little too much love this time around. Overall, these subclasses are all varying amounts of way too good. When balanced for each other, they're fine, but if you take a look at what's available in the PHB or even some of the stuff in Xanathar's guide, you might see that the power differential is just way too much. I don't know, maybe you disagree, and that's fine. I just don't like the idea that I might be seeing these reprinted into an official book, because then I'm gonna have to start breaking hearts. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, ring the reckoning bell, and maybe support me on Patreon so that I can afford a vacation after making 2 videos in 1 week. But yeah, Davy out.